But it does make me wonder what his playing would have been like above the 12th fret if he had had an actual left-handed guitar with a proper cutaway. I'm going to use this guitar to record it. It's just some high-up stuff. It's pretty easy. Shouldn't take me, you know, more than a minute or so. Nailed it. Folks, I have made some mistakes in my time as an online guitar instructor and YouTube guitar personality, but none of them hurts quite as much as this one, because this one I should have seen coming. This is a left-handed Strat that I converted for right-handed use by flipping the nut and restringing it, all to use in my new Hendrix Little Wing deep dive course. I thought I was being so slick. I'm playing a reverse guitar like Jimi Hendrix, and then I get into the course and realize, oh, I can't move my hand up any higher than this. I can't even play the chords that I need to play to teach the course that I bought it for. So the first point of this video is just to warn you what you're in for if you decide to go down this route, and for me to try and encourage you not to do that, not to make my mistake. The second thing is, I honestly am curious, because I didn't look before, what did Jimi Hendrix actually do when he played up high? So I have a couple of YouTube videos that we're going to look at, spots that I've bookmarked where you can clearly see his hands. So just a quick rundown of what I don't like and why this was a mistake. First of all, look at the offsets, the cutaways for your leg. When you have it this way, it's a pretty balanced guitar. But when you have it resting on this side, the peak of the groove is just a little bit in, which leaves more of the guitar on that end, which makes it just a little bit more prone to be whatever the opposite of neck heavy is. This is body heavy. And so that sets off that balance. And if you sit down for your playing guitar like I do for these lessons, that's annoying. So I have my guitar won't slip no more thing to help, but that doesn't solve the weight problem. It still is off. Second thing is, I've had nothing but trouble keeping this thing in tune. Maybe that's user error, I don't know, but I've had an incredibly hard time keeping it in tune. Intonating it has been difficult. There was some weird string warble stuff that I had a really hard time getting rid of. I think it has to do with the overall length and tension of the low strings. And then obviously the big thing is the upper fret access, which is what I started with talking about. So all in all, I think this is a terrible idea, and it makes me wonder if the only reason Jimi did it was because everything I've read seems to indicate he just took off-the-shelf stuff. He didn't have stuff custom made. He just kind of took whatever he got and just made it work. And I don't know, maybe if you're knowledgeable in guitars, comment below this video and tell me what the situation with left-handed guitars was back in the 60s when Jimi was touring and everything like that. Maybe it was just too hard to get left-handed guitars, especially if you happen to be somebody who, I don't know, maybe you will smash it or light it on fire, depending on whether the mood strikes you. So that's my little rant about how bad of an idea this was. Now let's get to the good part and take a look at Jimi Hendrix and his playing up above the 12th fret. We're going to see what he actually did. So I've got a couple of videos here that I've bookmarked. The tool that you're looking at is something called the TXBA Pro Player. This is something that I built, and my members use it to study all my courses as part of the membership, but they also have the ability to bookmark YouTube videos. So I have a couple of Hendrix ones bookmarked here, and we're gonna go through them. The first one is Voodoo Child Slight Return live at Maui. Let me zoom in using the video zoom feature. And you can see this is Voodoo Child Slight Return, which is in the key of E flat, which when you're tuned down a half a step like Jimi, that would put him, he's right about at the 12th fret here. Just watch what he's doing or not doing. Okay, it sounds like he's playing high, right? but he's doing it on the high E string. He's not having to access any of these strings up here, so he's just bending out of the box one shape there. All right, and the tuning on some of his performances was like in between, so I'm not going to try and play along with anything that he's doing here, because it's just going to sound bad. What he's doing here, it kind of sounds high. Still just in the box one shape, nothing too high going on. So he's doing a lot right here at the 12th fret position, but he's not going out of that, so he's staying within the range of what's accessible. Let's go to the next one here. This is a Machine Gun at the Isle of Wight. I've got a couple places bookmarked. This one almost sounds like he's tuned to D. Now we're looking at the back of the neck here, so it's a little hard to tell. I think maybe his guitar, maybe the whole band is just tuned a little bit lower, but it looks like he's using the same 12th fret position here, and he's just bending on the high E string, just like we were looking at in Voodoo Child. Let's go to another spot here. Turn on video zoom so we can see it better. All right, take a look at his hands right there. So his index finger is at the 15th fret. Now, I realize that I'm tuned different because this is one of the shows where I think the whole band was just, they were in tune together, but not tuned to a proper key. So he's doing box two bends here. And so you can see him reaching, and the headstock or the cutaway from his guitar would be cutting him off right about there. So his middle finger is hitting right about, like you can see on this guitar, right about here. So the question is, does he ever move higher than that? Now he's back in the box one shape. So that's why I love this example, because if you're listening to this in your car, you're imagining he's playing super high on the fretboard, because why wouldn't he be? But he's actually not, and he's limited by how high he can go by the guitar that he's playing. You can hear a lot of that kind of bending on his blues album when he covered the Albert King song. Let's go to the next one. Now, I like the song Foxey Lady as an example here, because when you're tuned down half a step like him, that puts your root fret right here at the second fret, because F and E flat tuning would be here at the second fret, which means his box one shape will now be two frets higher than what it would be for a song that's an E flat. So let's go and let's take a look at this. I have a spot bookmarked. That note. Just take the box one shape at the 14th fret. Okay, that's at the 17th fret that he'd be bending from, which is one of the last frets that's super easy to get to. And if you're using light strings, which I think he was using, he can bend it pretty far, kind of like Albert King. So that's the highest he went. There. That bend, it sounded like he was bending from the root note. So that would have been at the 19th fret. Okay, so now we're getting into some of that area that's hard to get to. That would be from the 19th fret or a really wide bend from the 17th fret, which I can't really do with the strings that I have on here. So far, let's step back. Big picture, it seems like when he's playing up high, he's mostly sticking to stuff in the box one position, which in a lot of these songs is at the 12th fret if it's a song in E flat, or in this case, F at the 14th fret. And maybe he goes into box two, but if he does, it's only on the higher string, so he's able to reach for the bend, but he's not doing any full chording stuff further up on the neck. Let's go to our next example here, Foxey Lady at the Miami Pop Festival. Let's take a look at this one. and let's see what I got bookmarked. Right. Back. Okay. Look at where his hand is at. This is the cutaway. Look at where my hand is, bending at the 17th fret. Cutaway is coming right there, so I think he's just bending on the high E string. So let's take a look at it one more time, zoomed in. Right there, you can see where his hand is lined up, where he's bending, I'm pretty sure again. Where my hand is on the fretboard, I can still reach here at the 17th fret. I can't go too much higher, but I can still bend right there. All right, let's keep going a little bit. Okay, and then of course it's a 70, so we got to do weird stuff like freeze the video. Last one. This is the Wind Cries Mary live at Monterey. I like this song for the purposes of this video because it's in the key of E. In the key, when you're tuned down half a step. Put your root fret, the 13th fret, or the first fret, which means that anything he tries to do up here is going to be pushing into the boundaries of what we're looking at. So let's go to this part right here. That's the part in the solo. That would just be at the 9th fret, so nothing hard or hard to reach going on there, but this. Looks high up. That's just happening at the 13th fret. This part is what I'm interested in. Look at where his hand goes. There he's playing a partial G form chord at the 15th fret with the 17th fret on the A string, but you notice he is never fretting the whole chord with the note on the A string. It's... I apologize for the intonation issues. I talked about that before. So he does get this chord played at the 15th fret. And so, but you can tell he is being crowded by this closer up cutaway. So I felt kind of validated when I saw this because I realized even Jimi with his gigantic hands, it seems like it was enough of a limitation that when he did play above the 12th fret, he did not use the full range of chords and expressions that he did everywhere else on the fretboard. Because of this cutaway issues. Now, he could reach for certain bends that I obviously can't get to because my fingers are not nearly as long as his. But it just goes to show that, you know, he was human just like the rest of us. But it does make me wonder what his playing would have been like above the 12th fret if he had had an actual left-handed guitar with a proper cutaway. We'll never know, obviously. Actually, that's a good challenge. If you can find a video of him playing a Strat that was an actual left-handed guitar with a proper amount of cutaway, post it in the comments for me to check out, and maybe I'll do a video if I can find any spots him playing up high. So anyway, this was a mistake. I'm not sure what I'm going to do with this guitar. I kind of think I'm just going to have a luthier put a left-handed nut back on it and then get it back to normal and then just sell it to a left-handed guitar player. Lord knows there's enough trouble for lefties to find enough guitars. So maybe I'll just put this one back into their pool of available instruments. Thanks for watching. If you're into Hendrix and Little Wing, check out my course, Little Wing Deep Dive. In production right now, will be available to purchase when it's done. Thanks for watching.